Somerville, it is time for, yes, you have it, Art at SCAT. And today, another fabulous, fabulous artist. We have Becky Carpenter, who you may have seen around Somerville. And she has this talent, and she picks out these subjects that are going to blow you away. So welcome to the show.
Thank you.
It is so cool. We have a friend in common, Raj.
That's right.
And he's been here a couple of times showing his artwork. And he said, have I got someone for you to meet? And I'm glad, you know, because your work, you know, when we were talking, it's interesting work. Look at you. You're like all excited about it. And I don't blame you. It's really, really cool. So tell us about yourself. Tell us about your art. How did you start painting? And is painting your only medium?
Painting, drawing, I also do photography. Really, I just try to dabble in anything. I also do other random things like bookbinding and that type of thing. I've been drawing and painting, well, mostly drawing off and on all my life, but last year I made a New Year's resolution to start drawing and painting every single day.
Have you been keeping to that?
Off and on. At first I did, and then things started to pick up and I started to show my art around more, and I didn't have the time to do it every day, but I think it's really like helped me build that habit and get into painting a lot more.
Wow, it also got you into the habit of showing your work more.
It's true.
So really you didn't realize it, but you just tripled your goals of what you did. So people, if you're looking for, already you're teaching us something. New Year's coming up, yep. New Year's resolution, you will create more artwork.
That's right.
And then you can just find Becky and thank her for that.
Draw every day.
Yeah, draw every day. I did meet an artist once that drew every day. She had a plant at Brick Bottom.
Wow.
And she drew every day. And I thought, this can be sort of monotonous, but yeah, the plant grows.
Yeah.
And then I tried to figure out, how could I do that? And then I realized I was doing it on the T.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
And just look at the work that you've produced. Now tell us about this piece.
So this is called Blooming, and it's on wood panel, which I've recently gotten into doing wood panel. I did this one about, I think, in the summer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What is it, like, what kind of paint did you use?
So yeah, this is acrylic. I do most of my work in either acrylic or watercolors.
Yeah, it's easier.
I don't really do oils.
Yeah, watercolor though to me is a challenge.
Yeah, it is challenging.
And then, let's see, the imagery, she's beautiful. She's absolutely beautiful. And then the flowers around her, very delicate. So you're very strong with her image. And I love the way you have the light on her. So I'm gonna take her down if I can and show people. Because getting light and reflection on a face is very difficult. And you did a beautiful job here. I love this area.
Thank you.
Around the lips. And then the hair too.
Thank you.
It's just really gorgeous. And the blue, that's a nice shade of blue.
Yeah, I'm really drawn to vibrant colors, even though I don't wear vibrant colors. I think that, you know, in nature really inspires me a whole lot. And I think that the idea of, you know, a young girl sort of like coming into her own was just very inspiring to me for this one. You know, just this idea of like, kind of cliche, like flowers blooming and she's also blooming in her own way.
Yeah, that could be the cover of a great book for young girls who, you know,
yeah,
who are blooming and in these challenging times.
That's right.
She maintains respect. She's centered, which is a really nice thing. Not just centered here, but you get a sense of that this person, I feel like she's real. And that she's centered, and she knows what she wants, and she knows what she's going for. And she has all this positive energy around her. Now, you did mention that you used wood.
Mm-hmm.
This is, so can I flip it around to show people? Some of you may be familiar with this. So does this, and what did you do? You didn't have to make this, you bought it like it is.
No, I just bought it like that.
And did you have to treat it first?
I haven't treated it yet. I'm going to clear coat it.
Okay.
At some point.
But you wouldn't treat it before, because then the paint wouldn't adhere, would it?
I don't know. I mean, my whole thing is I just try things and see if it works.
Okay, lesson number two, try different things. Resolutions and try different things.
I'm sure somebody out there is like, no, you have to treat it first. And
it's light.
Yeah.
So this is great. Like if you're hanging things, you don't have to worry about, it's like a balsam, is it? No, it's very light.
Yeah, it's a very light wood.
So you don't have to worry. It's not cumbersome. Even if you did something bigger, mm-hmm. it still could be manageable, which is really nice. And the colors, the flowers, are these your favorite flowers? Are these real flowers? Are they flowers from the garden in the mind of Becky?
Yeah, mostly in the mind, in my mind. I think they're based on some kind of flower, but I don't know.
They look real. And I love that you, here it's sort of unfinished.
Yeah.
But through here, it's just, I just love the way instead of doing a traditional green, you use the blue for the leaves. So it's very refreshing. And I love that in her ear, it almost looks like she could be a Vulcan with that ear, you know, that's so beautiful. And then, I don't know if you can notice, but when you come to see Becky in January, you'll see that there are also these delicate splatters around. Now, were they intentional or
yes.
are they?
Yes. Yeah, I like this idea of just developing and things appearing. And things happening.
So when you look at it, it's very simple because there's no background. You've used the material as the background. It's untreated, and then it makes the image pop even more. And so I enjoy this piece. Enjoy it a lot. And then we have, if you could...
Which one next?
Oh, no, I'll take this one. Now we're changing moods. Okay. And this shows Becky's sense of humor, because tell us about this.
So this is the first painting, the first completed painting I've ever done.
Mm-hmm.
I did it about a year ago. And it's called School Portrait. And
it's the way it feels when you're getting your school portrait done.
Yeah, yeah. And also I'm a little obsessed with old-timey portraits and how, I guess, uncomfortable everybody looks. Because when you have your picture taken or your portrait done, you have to sit for a long time and you're sort of nervous and you want to make sure it comes out okay. You want to be very still. And I just really love this idea of, like, you know, playing on that portrait idea along with this idea of a skeleton sitting for her portrait.
It's like you feel vulnerable.
Yeah.
When you're sitting there, I hate having my pictures taken.
Me too.
And so it does feel like that. And it's like an x-ray into what's going on.
Right.
And you have, I love the dress, and it does look like that school portrait dress that your mom
She's
would
all
pick
dressed
out.
Up, yeah.
Yeah. And mom's like saying, smile for the camera, smile
yeah.
for the camera, and they don't smile. And then you have this image, and then still all this girly, the flowery stuff, and then you could see the mother going, I told you to smile.
Yep.
Told you to smile.
Yep.
So that's, I love your sense of humor. And you capture the angst of, like, elementary school students trying to go for that picture. And I collect old photographs. And I have photographs from 1800s.
Yeah.
Everybody looks
Everybody
like this.
Everybody looks like that, yep.
And in fact, in the 1800s, I don't know if you knew this, but to get people to sit straight, they had a brace on their neck to pull them back for posture. So a lot of those times when you saw people too straight, they literally had something gripping the back of their neck and pulling them.
That's comfortable.
So you're just like getting, you've gone, you didn't know it, but you traveled back in history to tell us something about that. I think that is so wonderful, though, because it does, smile for the camera. That's not my good side. Nobody ever gets my good side. And here, like, nobody got my good side.
That's right.
And you can see right down into my heart. Hans is over there laughing. He's our camera crew. And he's like, oh, okay. Because he's always had a cute picture of himself. So he doesn't know the stress that
understand.
We have. But when some people go all out.
Yeah.
And yet, and you know what's the beauty of this too? In a world of selfies,
yeah.
This is the contrast. because I watch more people do selfies and I cannot figure it out.
It's like the modern day self-portrait.
It's just like, people spend more time everywhere. And I don't know if some guy was trying to impress some woman, but he took a picture of himself on the bus. I mean, that's the last place I would have done a selfie.
I don't know about that.
But this is so contrary to that. I love that image. Oh,
yeah,
I really do.
It still makes me smile every time I look at it.
And the buttons. And it's sort of a Victorian dress.
Yeah.
But it's still like something your mom would pick out for you. Pick the pretty dress out.
Here's your dress.
Yeah, and this is the one that's so flattering. No one else likes it.
Yep.
Your mother loves it, and that's what you get.
Yep.
I like when kids protest, too, when they wear, like, a fireman's hat for the picture, and it's like, oh, no. Or a gi.
You're gonna regret that later.
So, very nice. And again, now, the framing of this. What material did you use? What kind of paint?
This is acrylic on canvas.
It's very rich.
I like acrylic a lot. It dries very, very fast, which a lot of people, I guess, don't like. But I like that it's... You can just paint over it if you don't like it. You keep it light.
That's what I love about acrylic, too, because I have ADD. And so I'm not happy with an image. It's gone.
Yeah.
And I've had people look at me and go, wasn't that a tree 10 minutes ago? And I go, I hated that tree, so I made it a face. But very nicely done. How long did it take you to do this?
I think I worked on it on weekends for a month.
Okay. And what's your studio space look like?
I don't have one. This I did on my couch.
Okay, so that tells you. You're giving us lots of lessons. Studio space can be anywhere.
Yeah.
You know, couch, living. I'm afraid to paint anything on my couch because I'm afraid the paint will go on the couch. But I've set up, like, kitchen.
I'm on the floor a lot of times. This one I did on the floor.
Yeah, face down. It was
on, like, on
and
the
an
ground.
Easel.
And then
oh, you went flat.
Yeah, sometimes I do flat. Sometimes I have my easel on the ground. Sometimes I have it on my coffee table. Just
you're good.
Move it all over the place.
I use different size easels and stuff.
Yeah.
Very nice. And the framing on this is your traditional frame. And it's called...
This one's called School Portrait.
School Portrait, okay. Very nice. And when you come in to see her work in January, bring your moms, all those people that want you to pose for those pictures. Teachers should understand this. Okay. This looks very Shakespearean.
Too much glare.
I'm thinking theater, but tell me about this.
So this is a still life that I did. It's actually called Still Life and Death.
Nice play on words. I like that.
I actually started taking painting classes at the Catherine Widmer School of Painting,
mm-hmm.
Which is up here in Somerville, and she's really great. And so I did this one in the fall term. It took me a long time. This is probably the longest one that I've done. It's also acrylic on canvas.
It's amazing. You know, you keep a very simple palette. And you work that palette. From my angle, it looks like a photograph. It looks like shimmering from the skull and the candlesticks. And even the candlestick holders, but the candlesticks have this like shimmer of light that you really captured.
Thank you.
It's a good eye for that detail. When you come in, you're gonna see, like you squint, you walk back from her work and you go up close. Even the detail, it looks like a rich velvet. And I've always found it hard to do any setting like that where you have the two planes.
Yeah, it was challenging.
Because she's going like this. She did a backdrop and then foreground. And that's very difficult to do. And then, is this a mini pumpkin?
It's a mini pumpkin.
And there are white pumpkins.
Yeah.
Was that a really white pumpkin that you just, okay. And then I love the reflection of the purple and the black, because that's what you're using, basically, purple and black.
Yeah, I think the whole palette that I used was purple, yellow, and black.
Because it's hard to believe that this isn't fabric back here. It's so rich. When you come in to see this, you're going to want to touch, but don't touch. But it looks as though it's layers of rich fabric. Like, I'm waiting for the rest of it to flow down. It's wonderful. And the depth of the eyes and what were you like creeped out using a skull or?
No, I actually took a photo reference from things around my house.
Okay.
Which should tell something about me because I have a skull hanging around my house that I used as my photo
we
reference.
We don't judge here. There are many things in people's heart, houses, and we know artists that, yeah, so. But the scale, how long did it take you to set up the still life?
I think I did it, I was pretty rushed, maybe 10, 15 minutes. It was pretty rushed.
Because those of you who don't paint, you need to set it up. And so you're setting up props to get the right position. And so you can get the depth right. And it just takes a lot of putting things in the right place. And
getting the lighting right.
And do you want to, you know, yeah, is the light going to come down? Will it give me more shadow? Will it not give me shadow? Do I want that to be a dark area or a light area or positive or negative area?
Mm-hmm.
So it's like working math. But it's math I like.
Yeah, it was fun.
And it's just, oh gosh, if when you come to see this, you're going to be amazed because you just want to, you feel like there's a tuck there and your finger should be able to go all the way back and lay on. And it just it looks like velvet. I don't know how you did that, but it looks like velvet. It's so rich. And just the candles, oh. That's why I thought it was Shakespearean. I thought to be or not to be, that is the question. Pumpkin, what do you think? And so, just really beautiful. Now, when you paint, you're painting not in your studio, you said, but anywhere.
Yeah.
Like, where do you paint something like this?
So this one I did at the School of Painting.
Okay.
Only. It was weird sitting at like a desk and painting because I don't normally do that. But yeah, it took a while.
And the Catherine Widmer
School.
I know I was there many years ago to visit, and she's an excellent teacher.
Mm-hmm.
She inspires people. If you're out there, Catherine, and you're watching, we would like to bring more of your students on into the show. I didn't even realize that you were one of her students.
Yeah, it just started.
And she's been a Somerville fixture. For many years.
She's been here for a long time.
And she's inspired a lot of people. And I imagine when you go to her classes, she has people from all over Somerville, different income levels, different skill levels. And they're all, it's amazing.
I mean, people drive 30 minutes to go take classes from her. She's great.
And 30 minutes in Boston time is like days. It's like days. But what was her response to this?
Well, so I she really loves it, but as I was painting it, I would say to her, "Catherine, what's wrong? What should I change? What should I fix?" And she would point out, and then the next week I would say, "All right, now what's wrong with it?" And she would point out, and it was very helpful actually to just instead of saying, you know, what's good about it, to just be like, "What is awful about this? Let me fix it."
Well, that's you though, because since you just knowing you in the brief time, you're blunt about your work and you're honest. So it's nice, like you would be a great teacher yourself because you give people,
yeah,
she just did a look, not me. But the way, you know, sharing and just the way that you had that relationship with Catherine to say, what am I doing here? People don't often look for that kind of feedback.
It's the fastest way to get better, I think. To just really like seek out that feedback and really try to improve. It's one of those things that it's not personal. It doesn't say anything about you or your skills. It just you just need that second set of eyes to figure out what's wrong and you know make it the best piece you can.
But not everyone feels that way. Sometimes they ask for feedback and they just want you to say
it's beautiful.
You know, and they don't intend. And then they're like, what do you mean there's a change that needs to be made?
Yeah, and I mean, you have to know what kind of feedback you need. Like, because there are times where, you know, that's the feedback you need for your soul, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then there's the feedback you need for your skills.
Yeah.
And you have to decide, what do you need today? Do you need that the feedback for your soul or the feedback for your skills?
And the other thing is where you're getting the feedback. And this is all important when you're an artist, because there's some people that I call them the emotional vampires, and they're not going to give you any good feedback.
Mm-hmm.
And then there are people like Catherine who can tell you, and then you have to be able to hear it.
Yep.
And then take that and work with it.
And she's great at telling you what you've done well and what needs improvement. She's just so great with the balanced feedback.
So the school is here in Somerville. It's another gem. And let's see, I am going to, oh, title of this?
Still Life and Death.
Oh, okay, that's right. It's just, it's wonderful. And then if you could hand us this piece. For a change in pace. Now, title?
This is, I have no title for this.
It's like a dream.
Yeah. So this is watercolor on paper.
Mm-hmm. Now, do you wet the paper? Or do you work dry?
I do both, actually.
Okay.
Depending. I think this one I did more dry. But yeah, I do both.
It's quirky. Because it's, you have this, and then suddenly you have the skull right there.
Yeah, and her face is covered.
And so, yeah, it looks like, it's almost like a trademark for you. It's like it's a game.
Again.
It's a game that you're playing. But I love this because I love the moon. I love the way that you've semi-closed it like a C. And the colors. And you've even, to get the stars, did you mean for that? Did you use water in the background to do that? Because it looks like stars in here. So you did that?
Yeah, so when I do the white, I either use a white gel pen or white gouache.
Oh, okay. And then I love that it's casually framed. Like, you have it framed, but then you have this wonderful border around the edge that makes it just feel... so in depth, like you want her to turn around. You want the rest of the story. Well, at least, okay, this is saying about me. I want the rest of the story. And you used a very simple, you work with limited palettes.
Like, yes.
You don't do a lot of colors, but when you do them well. And
yeah, I try to limit the number of colors I use as much as possible.
And then you have, looks like a moon coming from the back too. And then you have the subtle, I love it's like a chartreuse or a yellow?
Yeah, it's like a yellow.
And then what is this magnificent color for our mermaid that you've done?
Like a gray, green, blue.
Did you mix it yourself?
Yeah.
Because that's beautiful. It has a precision almost of a pen and ink.
Yeah.
Which is really, really nice. And the... just detail. It's so sharp. It's very crisp.
Thank you.
This has been a real treat.
Thank you.
You've given us a lot of tips on, you know, how to create. Any other tips that you have?
Drawing every day is definitely the biggest. A lot of people have started, I don't know why they're asking me, but they started asking me how they can get better at art.
I can tell you why they ask you. Have you been seeing your work? This is a reason.
And the thing that I always tell them is to draw every day and draw everything around you as much as possible. And don't have any, try not to be self-conscious about it. Just sit and get an old notebook that you don't care about and just draw. And then that way it's not too precious. And you can just feel like you can put anything in it. And like experiment with as much as you possibly can. I started to just try things out, and you know, I don't have any, aside from going to Catherine Widmer's School of Painting, which I just recently started, I don't have any formal training in anything, so I'm just trying out whatever works.
Did you have any background? Were you doing any painting prior to this?
I haven't really done painting prior to this.
Drawing?
Drawing, yeah. A little bit of drawing.
And I was surprised how much drawing helps your painting.
I think so, too.
Because it helps you play with color. Because when I'm doing that, and I'm working with color pencils, it's amazing. You become more focused on the color and how it layers.
Mm-hmm.
And she's just beautiful. She is just like, we want to be there. And that skull just makes it look not serious. You know, but then it gives it like a whimsical, and I don't mean that. It just gives it a balance. Because some people go morbid.
Yeah, I don't think I'm a morbid person.
No, you're not. You don't do that. It's just beautiful. So you're going to be here for the month of January showing work. You're going to love her work. You need to come down. We'll do a reception, which will be arranged. And you can meet the artist. And she is quiet and soft-spoken. But you can see that when she starts talking about her art, she gets very serious. And she's given us some very valuable lessons about persistence, change, also changing materials, taking criticism, and that you, not criticism like you stink, but criticism,
yeah, no,
criticism.
Don't ever take you stink criticism.
You know, it's just, you're a wonderful teacher in that sense. I mean, you taught us today. She didn't think she was doing that, but she was. And I am so glad that she came down.
I'm glad I did too.
You know, and it's a rainy day, but you know what? It feels very bright and sunny in here. And I just love your work. It's calming. Even though if you said skulls, you'd think, huh, I don't think so. But yeah, it really is. I still think that this one reminds me of Shakespeare. Don't you? This is Shakespearean. See an actor going for that. Hans is looking at me going, I don't think so, but that's okay. And Hans is our camera crew tonight, and he does a magnificent job. And then we have the whole staff here at SCAT. So if public community access television, people support it, because this is what you get. You get to meet artists, writers, people in the community doing all kinds of cool things. You get the news. So support it, continue supporting it, so that we can have more talented artists and people coming in, sharing. And if you are an artist, a Somerville artist, please contact me through the SCATV, and we can bring you on. You lived through it, right? So it's not that bad.
It's survivable.
It's survivable. That's a big word for me. Thank you very much. And I hope you all have a wonderful new year. This is a great way to start the new year, with something that's fun and light. And I thank you for coming in.
Thank you for having me.
You know, we truly appreciate it. And everybody, I end my show always with Assalamu Alaikum, which means peace be to you. And I really mean that. These are challenging times. So keep creating and stay positive. Thank you all. And Hans did a great job. He's smiling now. He's stoic. So he's that man smile like that. But he's doing a great job. Thank you so much. This has been a fun show. It always is, though. I get fun audience, and, well, they're having fun, I hope. I have you. Thank you.